Hey guys, I'm Nandemo Guy for HackersCurator.com, and today we're bringing you a video that has been in the works for a very long time. We're going to be working on Dade Murphy's Luggable PC reproduction, and we're going to show you exactly how we made it. Let me start off by saying that this PC is not easy to come by. It took a lot of work, a lot of long searching to find both this working version as well as the version that we use in our reproduction. Now, I would never take a working vintage classic like this and cut it up to make a reproduction from a film, but I did, however, buy one that was not complete and not working and just a parts machine. So, just a disclaimer, all of the cutting and modifications are not done on this working machine. Let's jump right into it.
This is the Compact Portable 486C. It was released in 1992 as Compact's last entry into the portable PC market before transitioning efforts to laptop production. It came from an era where portable devices had doors and covers over most ports and connections. Physical locks were also commonplace, as seen here. A PowerBook 180C lent its internals to the original prop computers from the film. We will start with a quick disassembly of the Compact.
All right, so we've got the 486C broken down, so I think we're going to turn our attention to aligning and mounting the screen.
Taking just the screen trim from the PowerBook, we're simply going to get it as centered as possible and glue it to the inside of the Compact frame. Using a 640 by 480 screen, we now need to get it lined up for mounting inside the Compact chassis.
All right, so the screen is in place. Next, we're going to turn our attention to that little trackball in the corner of the screen. Now, someday I'd love to talk to the original makers of this prop and get their idea for why exactly they mounted this on the front of the screen. It's amazingly impractical, but surprisingly not unheard of for the era. In fact, Serial Killer's laptop also has a little trackball next to the screen. Anyways, let's get into it.
We're going to modify this trim piece to simply fill in the space where it was originally located. We'll fill in the holes with some two-part plastic resin, as well as give it some texture to match the rest of the computer. Now let's get the trackball lined up. I referenced the film multiple times to get it as close as possible. Using some two-part plastic resin, I filled the speaker grill, ready for modification. I don't exactly have many options to redo this if we get it wrong, so slowly but surely, I work my way to proper fitment. After a test fit, we need to cut some of the chassis out of the way and get this thing mounted in place. We'll be using a teensy 2 to ensure that the trackball actually works like a trackball. A quick test drive, and the trackball is ready for permanent installation.
Okay, the screen is in, the trackball is in,
Now it's time to tackle the single most labor-intensive part of this build. The keyboard on this project not only has to work, not only has to look the part, but if you noticed in the intro, it attaches to the front of the screen when it's in luggable mode. So everything has to fit and everything has to clear. We don't have a lot of room to make any mistakes.
The functioning part of the keyboard is from a Macintosh Keyboard 2. There were actually a crazy number of screws holding the compact keyboard together. Most of them are under the keys, so let's take all of those off. There's also three on the back under the rubber feet and a trim piece, and even more under the plastic labeling strip. Finally, once inside, we just need to take everything out. The Macintosh keyboard is far easier to disassemble. We need to remove the ribbon connectors here from the board. The keyboard unfortunately doesn't quite fit right out of the box, so we're going to need to do some trimming and reshaping. Once everything is filled and sanded, we hit it with some primer and get started on mapping the keys. Using a Teensy 2++ and doing some programming, we're able to get the keyboard functioning. Take a look in the background of this screenshot. It's the only scene where the bottom of the keyboard is actually seen. There is some extensive build-out required here. We found some old compact plastic panels to use to make the bottom box. Now with the body in order, we just need to create some screw covers for the surface to match the film. We used a handful of references from the film to try to get the camouflage pattern just right.
Okay, so the hardest parts of the build are out of the way, but we're not out of the woods yet. I wanted to use some parts from the original power supply housing to keep the original power supply wire and to act as a good home for the speakers. This one doesn't require a lot of talking, and I really love the background music from Massive Attack, so I'll mainly let this segment speak for itself. If you have any questions, just leave them in the comments, and I promise I'll get to them. Okay, there's only a few pieces left remaining before we get to the final assembly. This next one is just pure old-fashioned fabrication work that hopefully everyone can appreciate.
If you ever happen to stumble across a 486C, chances are that this little door cover is missing from the side. Using the bottom of the Macintosh keyboard, we're going to make a replacement door. The basic shape is there, but I need to recess this section. The plastic just isn't quite thick enough though. Let's take care of that with some two-part plastic resin. I used a Dremel router here to cut it to shape, but it was really hard to film. Now we just need to thin the edges a little bit.
So all the fitting, fabrication, modifications, they're all done for this build. But the paint job was a job in and of itself. There were a handful of scenes from the film that we referenced to try to make the pattern as close as possible. But there are some sections of this build you just can't see. So we had to make those parts up for ourselves. With my attention to detail and just being a glutton for punishment, I spent over 2 days just trying to get the pattern right. Let's go ahead and start just by laying down a base coat and getting everything ready for the camouflage pattern.
I created a paper mask for the entire case, and as mentioned, we used several scenes from the film for reference, and hand sketched the camo pattern as closely as we possibly could. As far as we can tell, there must have been at least 2 camouflage props, as some parts of the pattern don't seem to be consistent between some of the scenes. Using a thumbtack here, I was able to essentially transfer the lines from the paper mask to the cardboard template.
that's it, guys. All the hard work's over. That means there's only one thing left to do. Let's put this thing back together. And there is Dade's Luggable PC. I hope everybody really enjoyed this build. It, like I said in the beginning, is a long time coming. We started this project probably close to 2 years ago. Now granted, there's a few things we did not film. We actually made the floppy drive work on this machine, but not as a traditional floppy drive. We actually stripped out all the interior of the drive, modified it, also took a floppy disk, and embedded an SD card into it, so it truly functions like an SD card reader. It was really cool, but honestly, I didn't know if I was gonna be able to make it work when I started, so I didn't film the progress. But I think I'm gonna do this in a future build, so we'll film it at that time. Additionally, we did not get the sort of shoulder straps, or the guitar strap, if you will. I'm looking for the brackets. You really only see them in one scene of the movie anyways, when Nikon is holding Dave's computer while he's doing some hacking work. But it's something eventually I will get done. This is now the second of the computer repros we've done from this film, but it is certainly not the last. I'd like people to leave in the comments what they'd like us to go after next. We have everything we need to do them all. We could do Dade's clear laptop. We could do Serial Killer's laptop. We could even do Renly Santiago's laptop or Phantom Freak's laptop that's really only seen on his desk. So that one might be a bit tricky, but leave us a note in the comments. Let us know what you'd like us to do next. As always, guys, I'm Nondemo Guy from HackersCurator.com. We really appreciate all the support from our Patreon supporters, as well as all the fans of Hackers in general. We've got a ton more stuff coming up, and we hope you stick with us.